You're not going to want to miss this episode of the AI Show, where we talk about managed online endpoints, now generally available. My good friend Sethu, make sure you tune in. Hello and welcome to this episode of the AI Show. We're talking about managed online endpoints, now generally available as of Microsoft Build 2022. I've got my good friend Sethu. All right, my friend, tell us who you are and what you do.
Hey, Seth. My name is Sethu Raman, and I'm a product manager in Azure ML, driving the managed endpoints capability.
Fantastic. Now, this is probably one of my favorite features of all of Azure Machine Learning, because getting models into production is probably the hardest part of all of this. For those that don't know about this feature, why don't you give us the elevator pitch?
Yeah, absolutely. So managed endpoints gives you a turnkey way to deploy your ML models in scale at production without you having to worry about the underlying infrastructure. In your previous sessions that we had on the AI Show, we talked about how you can do interactive debugging, how you can configure auto-scaling, and how you can roll out a new version of the model using your CI/CD pipelines.
Yeah, and it's been really cool to be able to do that, because not having to worry about all that stuff is awesome. So tell us, what's the new stuff as of Microsoft Build?
Yeah, so I have some exciting stuff to share today. Other than that, we are launching general availability in Build. Firstly, I brought a demo with me to show how users can scale to really, really high requests per second in a short amount of time with capability of our GitOps friendly APIs.
I love it. Let me roll it right now.
In this demo, I'm going to show you how users can self-serve their way to 100,000 queries per second. This will unblock large customers who were reluctant to onboard because of scale concerns. Shall we? Let's look at this setup, starting with the basics. We have a 32-core VM to run the load test. Here is the managed online endpoint and deployment. Here, each box represents a node, also called as an instance. Let's take a look at setup of one node. It's an 8-core machine. In this example, you can see only one worker process containing the inferencing components. To increase CPU utilization, we can increase the number of workers. This is our test setup. Since it's an 8-core machine, we configured 8 workers to increase the CPU utilization while not affecting the latency. We will use scikit-learn's diabetes model from our default example. Creating this deployment using our GitOps-friendly CLI is very straightforward. First, we configure the deployment properties in the YAML file. Here we have the instance type. You can see it's an 8-core F-series machine. And instance count, currently we just need one node. And then the worker count that we saw is 8. Now, we fire the create command using the CLI, passing the YAML as the input. Now, let's run the load test using a popular tool called WRK. It outputs the QPS and tail latencies. Let's see it in a better format. In our one node test, we got a peak QPS of 1600 and tail latencies of P50 to P90 between 4.7 to 6.2 milliseconds. Now, let's increase the scale up to 50 instances and run our tests. It is as simple as running the update command with the instance count set as 50. In 5.5 minutes, we are open for business. Typically, this takes somewhere between 5 to 7 minutes. Though, for our purposes, 50 nodes are enough. Let's do a quick sidebar on what it takes to scale up to 150 nodes. We use the same update command now, with the instance count as 150. And in this case, we are all set within 7 minutes. I ran the load tests on not only 50 instances, but also on intermediate node configurations. Let's compare. This slide shows the output for different test configurations, starting from one node, 10 node, and all the way through to 50 nodes. First, let's compare the tail latencies. For a single node configuration, you can see the P50 to P90 latencies are between 4.7 to 6.2 milliseconds. For 50 node cluster, you can see it is from 5.1 to 8.2 milliseconds. These seems to be reasonably close given the scale. You can also see the distribution of the QPS across these various nodes. Now let's see a plot of them. Here the x-axis shows the number of the nodes and the y-axis has the QPS. The plot shows near linear scale of QPS with respect to nodes. Let's get back to our original goal to achieve 100K QPS. With the same cost, that is, with 50 nodes, can we achieve 100K QPS? We can try this if we are willing to trade off increase in tail latencies. We can tune for high throughput by increasing the worker count. In this case, we'll push the boundary by changing the worker count from 8 to 48 per node. Now, let's run the test with a 50 node cluster with the increased worker count. You can see that we have in fact reached 100,000 QPS. Yay! Let's compare. You can see that the new configuration has better QPS, but we had to trade off with the increase in tail latencies. This is good enough for our use case. However, we can always easily add more nodes to reduce the latencies. To summarize, high-scale customers can now self-serve their way to hundreds of thousands of QPS.
So just to, a couple of, because that, first of all, that was awesome. 100K queries per, that's QPS means, queries per second.
Yes.
In under 7 minutes, we're able to deploy that. Fantastic. You mentioned tail latencies, and there was like, I think it was P50, P60, P, what does that mean?
So when you want to measure the user experience of the clients that's making the request, you know, the response time, people, you know, average is one way to do that, but it does not capture the stragglers. Tail latencies, for example, P90, let's say it's 6 milliseconds, that means that 90% of your users will experience latency of 6 milliseconds or less.
Oh, I see. I see. So it's basically the latency for the percentage of people, the best percentage, the best latency for the 50%, 60%, 90%. Did I get that right?
That is perfect.
Then the other thing that was maybe, go ahead.
Yeah. So when you, for like applications which have very tight SLA, they typically may like measure, let's say P90, P95, or sometimes even P99 latencies. That's what they care about.
Oh, I see. Okay. This makes a lot more sense. The second thing that was not altogether clear for me was that the increasing worker count, increasing node count, causing issues. Can you explain that a little bit?
Yeah, absolutely. So the overall goal of this demo is to, first of all, showcase to users, hey, you are able to kind of really scale up to very high requests per second or queries per second by using configuration, our declarative API. And that our system is kind of open. So when we, in each worker, let's say in our case, we had like an 8 CPU machine, and we started with 8 workers or like 8 processes, right? So these are the inference containers and 8 processes that are running that will kind of serve the request. And if we, you know, there is still, you know, a lot of times these processes wait, they're not using the CPU all the time. So when they are 8, okay, they're doing good. Because we match one CPU core to this indirectly. But when I want to squeeze more juice out of the CPU, I can keep adding more processes. But then there's going to be, the trade-off is going to be, you're going to be able to handle more requests, but because of the lot of context switching that happens, there is going to be additional latency. So that's the trade-off. So if you have very low latency application, you don't want to, you know, squeeze a lot of workers, but if you're willing to trade off and you want to reduce your cost, then that's a good way.
Okay, so I think I understand. Basically, each worker, if you're on an 8 CPU machine, if there's 8 workers, then they're pseudo mapped one to CPU. But then the more workers that you have, the more contention there is between context switching, etc.
That's right.
Fantastic. Any other cool things, announcements from Microsoft Build that you want to talk about?
Absolutely. So I have 2 new features that we are public previewing as a part of Manage Online Endpoints based on, you know, a lot of customer asks. So I'll give you like a quick sneak peek of what's coming here.
Let's do it.
So the first one is mirror traffic. Seth, if you recall in your last show, we talked about safe rollout. In this, we talked about how you can use percentage of live traffic diverted to a new version of the model, and then make sure that model is working properly before we divert more traffic to that model and become 100% from blue to green, right?
I remember that.
Yeah. So one of the challenges with that capability is when you transfer live traffic, let's say even you transfer 5% of live traffic to a new model to test, what if the deployment is faulty, there are some issues with that, then your SLA is going to be affected because 5% of your request might fail now. So what we are launching right now is a capability called mirror traffic, in which, as you can see in the picture, the V1 of the model will take still continue to take 100%, but now you give a percentage of that as a mirror traffic. In this case, I'm diverting 10% traffic to the green, but the response from green is not sent back to the client. So it's done internally, but still you can go and measure your metrics to make sure that, hey, am I meeting my response time requirements? Are there no errors? So you can see all your metrics and make sure your SLA is doing good before you divert real traffic to it. So that's the mirror traffic capability.
That's really cool. I can imagine scenarios where you might not even want to divert. Let's just say you have an SLA of you know, three nines, for example, and you divert 5% of your traffic to green when it doesn't work at all and you don't know. All of a sudden, you're at 95%, which is not good. This basically just mirrors the traffic, and then you can monitor how it's handling the requests.
That is right. That is right.
That's really exactly cool.
And to use this, it's very, very straightforward. And you can see in the bottom, users would have seen this online endpoint update API already available. You just need to set this mirror traffic, and you can set it to whatever percentage that is needed.
Amazing. That's really cool. Any others, or do you still have any other surprises?
Yes, one more thing. Cool. A big ask from our enterprise customers. This is the network isolation support. We worked on this to make sure it's as declarative and simple for people to adopt, rather than people go and configure a lot of NSG rules in their VNet. You know, we want to reduce the setup overhead here. So here we support both ingress network isolation for both ingress and egress through private endpoints. So the first command, so it shows you how you can secure the ingress to a private endpoint to your online endpoint through private endpoint, workspace private endpoint. So all you need to do is when you do the endpoint create, you add this flag that's highlighted, like set public network access as disabled. So this means there is no public IP available for endpoint, and all the accesses have to go through from your VNet through a workspace private endpoint. So this secures the ingress. And to secure the outbound communication or the egress from your deployment VMs to the external resources like the storage and ACR, you can do that by just adding this. When you do a deployment create, all you need to do is set the public network access as disabled here. So this way, we create private endpoints from the deployment to the ACR and blob store, for instance, and make sure that there is no internet access from the containers out. So this way you can secure both your ingress and egress, and both are independent in a way that you can have like a public endpoint with a private egress, or like the endpoint which is kind of private and the egress can be public. So you can set any combinations that you want.
Oh, this is so cool, especially when you have sensitive uses that you can do this. This is great stuff. Sethu, where can people go to find out more?
So there is a link that's going to be shared in the bottom of this AI show, and people can just go there and, there is a blog and there'll be links to tutorials on mirror traffic and network isolation.
This has all been really cool, Sethu. Thank you so much for spending time with us, my friend.
Thank you so much, Seth.
All right. We've been learning all about managed online endpoint, now generally available as of Microsoft Build 2022. Thank you so much for watching, and hopefully we'll see you next time. Take care.